maybe you don't need a big reorientation. Maybe you're doing fine, but sometimes we do, right? Especially with COVID, I can't quite keep up with how many times we closed down and then we opened, and then there's been weeks where I've had to isolate, or Martin's had to isolate, and just everything's up in the air and I need a reorientation. That's what I felt like this week, and that's what this passage has been for me. One of my favorite ways to exercise is to do a thing called ins and outs. It's really complicated. What you do is you go to the beach and then you go in, and then you turn around and you come out and run up and touch the wall. Ins and outs. I don't know why they call it that, but it's one of my favorite things to do, ins and outs. But one of the tricks for ins and outs at the beach with my surf club friends is, where do you stop when you get into the water? Like, what's the finish line in the water? And so some people are kind of naturally wired like me, and I stop a bit early, and I see all my friends keep swimming and they stop just a bit further out. And then some other people are wired differently than me. They just keep swimming and you're like, stop, you gotta stop there. Just doing little ins and outs, not big ins and outs. And between, you know, some water in your ear and your friend's foot in your face and the surf splashing around, sometimes you get really disoriented about how far out you are, where you should be compared to your friends, and it's just quite disorientating. And so, you know, the obvious thing to do is, as you move out in the bay, you know, because it's shaped like this, and you move out in the bay, and you might look over towards a building, and we'll say, we'll stop at the fourth building. But that's no good because of physics, because, like, any point on the circle, you can look at something, yeah, I'm directly in line with that building, but you're on an angle, actually. You need 2 points, right? 2 points. And so my friend who's an engineer, ingenious method, all the engineers in the room will love this, right? Okay, so we're swimming out, and we look at Ben Buckler, I don't remember which way it looks, but we're swimming out, which is confusing because it's called ins and outs, and we're swimming out the back of the break, and instead of just looking at a building, my friend, who's an engineer, has found that there's this laneway on Ben Buckler that you look up, and so it's clear space between the buildings, and there's a street lamp somewhere, and there's this antenna, and it gets to this point when you're swimming where they line up, and you know that you're on the straight line now, and we all stop there, and we all know where we're supposed to be. It's orienting. You just look up, and you can see it's way above the waves. You can see it, and you know exactly where you're supposed to be. It's this great, he's invented a new method. It's probably an old method. He's found a point, and it's very helpful, and we know where we are. And I think that Daniel chapter 5 just presents a few spiritual realities that you're not going to hear in the rest of your week if you're not reading the Bible. You're not going to hear these at your workplace. You might not hear them in your block of units unless you've got a really great Christian friend there. You're not going to hear them elsewhere, and God's going to orient you tonight with Daniel chapter 5. So I actually want you, I don't do this often, to pull out your device and just have your notes open, and I want you to lock in three things, and I want you to look at them tomorrow morning. And they're like the antenna and the light pole that line up. And I was praying about this afternoon and thought, I think this is going to be good to just place you in your week tomorrow morning. Maybe you'll remember, you know, write down, you know yourself. You do you. Okay, so Daniel chapter 5, it starts with a new king. That's really interesting because we've had Nebuchadnezzar all the way through. He's the king of Babylon who's carried off a bunch of Israelites and the temple worship items to Babylon. But now there is a new king called Belshazzar. And this is doubly interesting because actually one of the prophecies that Daniel made earlier in chapter two, was that there will be a number of kingdoms that come falling over one after the other as God does his thing. And we've seen the first has fallen over. And now we're up to the second one. Do you remember there was the different, there was a statue with a head of gold and shoulders of silver, et cetera, et cetera. Well, we're seeing the shoulders of silver now. We're about to. So chapter 5, verse 1 says, King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. Sounds like a good night, right? It's the king and he's having a party, and it's not just any party, it's 1,000 of his lords. And they're drinking wine together. But listen to verse 2. While Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the king and his nobles and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. Okay. So Old Testament primer, really quickly. Remember, the temple is this place on earth where God has said he will make himself present. He said, make bowls like this, make curtains with pomegranates that speak of abundance. Right? And do this, there's pages and pages of it in Exodus. Make a temple like this. And when you do that, Those things are not that special. But when you do it, I will make myself present and I will speak to you. I'll give you my law and I'll meet with you there. That's what you read at the end of Exodus. It's amazing. Anyway, but God's people have turned their backs on him. And as chapter 1 says, God has let them be carried off into Babylon, into exile, away from that place. And Nebuchadnezzar has taken not just the people, but some of those items from the temple of God where God makes himself present, and taken them and put them in the treasury of their God. It's a really sad moment in the history of God's people. But this just got worse. Belshazzar is flipping God the bird. He takes them out of the treasury and uses them at the party. That'd be funny. Let's get the stuff we took from Jerusalem, from their worship, and we'll use it. This is deep, dark, sacrilegious kind of stuff. He's drinking with his concubines and his wives and his nobles. And it says that's what they did. And verse 4, as they drank wine, they praise the gods of gold and silver, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone. And that very list is very similar to what we heard about that statue from chapter 2 of gold, silver, bronze, iron, and it's, I think it's clay mixed with something else. But it's reminding us of those things that will fall, and that's what they're praising. They're worshipping idols together. Well, as I said, they're flipping the bird to the God of Israel. Well, God is about to make a hand signal to Belshazzar too. The temple items are how God makes himself present. And I don't know if this is quite there in the text, but they're being misused. But nonetheless, God will be present with his temple items. Not because of how they're using them, but he's nonetheless going to make himself very present. Because look at Daniel chapter 5. This really is, to me, it fits into the genre of horror story. True as it is. Verse 5, suddenly the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. Eli, do you mind flicking us through? There's a picture of this that Rembrandt did for us. Thank you. Can you imagine that? Just a hand appearing and writing words on the wall. We'll find out what they are later. I'll just say that Aramaic, I'll just read the, what the translators have given us. Mene, mene, tekel, parson. It's terrifying. Just the idea of it, let alone what it says, which we'll get to later. Actually, I'll tell you what it says now, and then we'll talk about the meaning later. It's very similar to dollar symbol. Dollar symbol. Kilograms, division symbol. Very, very terrifying and very strange what happens on the wall that night. Would you not be just scared out of your mind if a hand appeared there and started writing something on the wall? That's just what's happened. And Belshazzar, he might be quite drunk, but he's also quite scared. Verse 7, the king summoned the enchanters. Back to verse 5. The king watched as the hand wrote. Verse 6, his face turned pale and he was so frightened that his legs became weak and his knees were knocking. He's scared out of his mind because it's not just a scary situation, which we can all see that it's a scary situation. He knows, I think I've done something wrong. Yeah, I've pushed it maybe a little bit too far over the line. And I find it intriguing. There's a bunch of connections with this story in chapter 5 and what we've already heard in chapter 1. In chapter 1, do you remember Daniel had said, look, can I not eat the royal food? And let me just have vegetables because I don't want to be defiled by what's going on here. And I think it was the chief guard, Ashpenaz, says, I fear for my life that the king will notice that you're weak and sickly if you don't eat the royal food. And Daniel says, let me just have a trial for 10 days and we'll see what I look like after 10 days. And Daniel eats only vegetables. And instead of looking pale and sick, he looks strong and fitter than all the other guys that have been trained up by the king. Very interesting. God provides for him in his stand of saying, I'm not going to worship other gods by eating that. On the other hand, King Belshazzar just does whatever he wants and flips the bird to anybody who tells him what to do, especially the God of Israel. And he has the royalist food, right? I'm guessing the wine was good that night and the meat was, you know, good meat. And yet now he is sickly and pale and his knees are knocking. I'm told that Aramaic means not that his knees are knocking, but that he actually toileted on himself. He's all over the place. And so, verse 7, the king summoned the enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. Then he said to these wise men of Babylon, whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain around his neck, and he'll be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then all the king's wise men came in, but they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. It's reminding us of earlier in the story. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar wanted to know what something meant, what a dream meant, and all the money in the world that he could, and threats in the world to help me understand this mystery of life, just wasn't enough. And do you remember in chapter 2, the astrologers say, this is impossible. You need the gods to tell you what this means, and they don't live among people. It's a very similar story going on here, where we see there are some things that no amount of human thinking is going to get you the answer. And I suspect if you're over the age of 18, you probably have started to come across some of those questions in life that no amount of human thinking fixes it. You need something outside of human thinking. Okay, and thankfully God has sent the Israelites, his people, with something bigger than human thinking into Babylon. Look at verse 10. And just notice, as I start to read verse 10, that it's been decades since God's people have been brought into a foreign land. Verse 10, the queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, came into the banquet hall. May the king live forever, she said. Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in you. In the time of your father, he was found to have insight, intelligence, and wisdom like that of the gods. Your father, King Nebuchadnezzar, appointed him chief of the magicians, enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. He did this because Daniel, a king called Belteshazzar, very similar to Belshazzar, was found to have a keen mind and knowledge and understanding, and also the ability to interpret dreams and explain riddles and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel, and he will tell you what the writing means. The queen says, there is someone who has this kind of insight into life. I think at this point in the story, here's one of the markers that just tells you where you are and what you're for and reorients you for your week. If you're one of God's people, you've been saved by Jesus, and remember, not out of merit, not because you're particularly special. Remember, Paul says in Corinthians, not many of you Christians were very noble by birth or very rich or very intelligent, but God's called you. So if you're a Christian who God has called, not because you're very special, you've got a job to do. And that is to be there for our neighbors around us when they have stuff like writing on the wall or deep, dark problems that no human knowledge can get into, ready to be called upon to bless them, ready to be called upon and speak wisdom into that kind of fear and speak spiritual realities into it. We as Christians have a role to play for our neighbors. And so I just want to ponder with you, do your neighbors know that you're a Christian? Did you notice how the queen described Daniel? There's this guy, he's got the spirit of the gods in him, and he's really wise. Do your friends know that you've got God's spirit in you? Now, it's really interesting because I've always felt astounded by the claim that the Bible makes that God has put his spirit in me, because I feel so plain sometimes, and so many of my days feel just pretty straightforward and like just not miraculous and huge. They just feel kind of normal most days. And then the Bible does say that God's spirit is in me, enabling me to see spiritual reality. And when I notice it, it is there. But I say that just because Daniel isn't here on the scene, and you think that if he's got the spirit of God in him, wouldn't everybody just be with him all the time? But it's not the most miraculous thing you've ever seen all the time, every day. Daniel's kind of, he must have been sitting in his room praying, or I don't know, just having dinner with his friends when he gets called in. So it might not be the brightest, shiniest thing that your friends have ever seen, but they do remember that Daniel has the spirit of God in him and that he has spiritual insight like we haven't seen before. And when the crisis does come, they do call on him. Someone remembers. And I just invite you even now just to think about your friends, to the people in your apartment block, at your workplace. Do they have a sense that you've got something from God? You might not be the brightest, shiniest person they've ever seen, but do they know that if they had a deep question that goes beyond human reason, that actually so-and-so talks about God sometimes, or and I don't mean you have to be the annoying one that kind of is always biting people's ear off. Just this morning, I stood at the back there with one of the unbelieving dads who comes to our playgroup church that we have on Sunday mornings. He said, I love coming here. I'm really enjoying the stories. A few weeks ago, he said, every week, these stories, they apply to my work, what Jesus is saying. Okay, so he's not a Christian guy, but he's just really loving what he's getting, and he's engaging and seems to me to be eating up. I've been enjoying it, like, wow, something tasty eating up. And he said to me this morning, he said, I really like coming here. I was in the city yesterday, and there was a guy on the town hall steps with tracts and stuff, and he was just yelling at everybody. He thought he had really good news, but he was just yelling at people. I don't like that at all. And I don't want to speak against that guy. If he's led one person to Jesus in the last 10 years, that's worth it. But what I'm saying is we don't need to yell at our friends. This passage is suggesting just be the one who is known as someone who has a connection with God. And people will call on you and ask for your help and be ready to speak the wisdom of God into their lives. Okay, so this is the first marker I want you to write down. Just that we have a role, and that is to be there for our friends, ready to speak spiritual wisdom to them. They'll call on us. And here's an idea. I get it easy as a pastor because people say, hey, what do you do? And I say, I'm a pastor. And then they run. or at least in their face they run. Or they're interested. In Bondi, I find most people just interested in chat, which is great. But sometimes people freak out. But I get to tell people I'm a Christian easy because people just say, oh, what do you do? But it can be a little harder, but I think it's worth just trying to flag it to your friends, not to yell in their face in some kind of ugly, intense way, but just so they know that you're there when they want to call on you. And I think a great way to do this is to pray for people. Now, actually, I think it's great to pray for people just for the sake of praying for people, but there's been so many times when I've been able to say to a friend who I know doesn't have faith himself, hey, I pray. I just know that God either changes situations or changes me. So can I pray for you about that thing? And just depending on how much I know them and what I know about them, I'll say, can I pray with you now? Or I'm going to be praying about that this week. And it just flags to people, I care about you. I have a trust in a God and I think he can do things. That's just a great way to put it out there, that you're there for them if they want more about some of those deeper questions in life and those darker moments in life that he's got to go through. All right, that's point number one, Michael, number one. Okay, so the queen talks about Daniel and says, you should call him and he'll tell you what the writing means. Verse 17. I skipped just a little bit of the story there because beautifully, Daniel's quite repetitive, but for time's sake, I'm going to skip just a few verses. And Daniel's brought to the king, and verse 17, then Daniel answered the king, you may keep your gifts for yourself and give your rewards to someone else. Nevertheless, I will read the writing for the king. Tell him what it means. Daniel is called. He says, I don't need the purple stuff and the gold, but I'm going to tell you. And I think there's something there, which is he's not there for what he can get out of the situation. He's just there to serve. He just wants to speak the truth when he's invited into the situation. And so in verse 18, interestingly, he doesn't listen to this. He doesn't go straight to the message on the wall. First, he's going to give some context to the king about the writing. Listen. Verse 18, Your Majesty, the Most High God gave your father Nebuchadnezzar sovereignty and greatness and glory and splendor. Because of the high position he gave him, all the nations and the peoples of every language dreaded and feared him. Those the king wanted to put to death, he put to death. Those he wanted to spare, he spared. Those he wanted to promote, promoted. And those he wanted to humble, he humbled. But when his heart became arrogant and hardened with pride, he was deposed from his royal throne and stripped of his glory. He was driven away from people and given the mind of an animal. He lived with wild donkeys and ate grass like an ox, and his body was drenched with the dew of heaven until he acknowledged that the Most High God is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth and sets over them anyone he wishes. This is what Matt Graham shared 2 weeks ago, remember? That story from just the last chapter. Verse 22, but you, Belshazzar, his son, have not humbled yourself. Though you knew all this, instead you have set yourself up against the Lord of heaven. You had the goblets from his temple brought to you, and you and your nobles, your wives, and your concubines drank from them. You praise the gods of silver, gold, bronze, of iron, wood, and stone, which cannot see or hear or understand. But you did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. Therefore, he sent the hand that wrote this inscription. It's very interesting. Daniel's called, I don't want stuff. I'm going to tell you what it means, though. And he doesn't tell him what it means. He gives him a huge bit of context. And it's a bit of context that Daniel himself says, and you already knew this. And that's the point. Is he said, you knew what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. He lifted himself up against God, and God lowered him. And the Bible, and particularly this book and Luke's gospel, talk about the fact that our God is a God who will lower people who are too high, who lift themselves up. And that's what Daniel tells him. And as I say, says to him, even though you knew this, you still set yourself up, and that's the word he used, you set yourself up against God. And I want you to notice who God is. And here's the second point. You can start lining up polls. Here's the second point to write down. He talks about who this God is, and it makes all the difference about setting yourself up against him. He says in verse 23, yes, verse 23, in the second half, he says, you did not honor, which God? You did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. I really want you to reorient yourself tonight with this point. Who is our God? What's his deal? Which God? What is this God? Is the God who holds your life in his hands right now and all your ways. What boring things did you do today? What fantastic things did you do today? What sin did you do today? What just great, you know, blessing did you do today? All your ways are in his hands. And right now, he holds you. And 10 years ago, and in 10 years' time, if he decides to keep holding you in his hand alive, that is the God that we have. This is an intimate picture of God, not a distant God, even though I feel like he's distant sometimes. He's not. He's holding me right now in his hand. That's the God that we know. And that's the God that Belshazzar has set himself up against. And that's the God that we set ourselves up against, and that our neighbors, our friends, our family, our workmates set themselves up against that God. You've got to write this one down because it does orient you about what kind of a world and what kind of a place do I live in? What kind of a deal is this? What's the setup? I remember that I've always had a kind of faith, since I was teeny tiny. I remember trying to pray. I remember trying to, I don't know, ask God to do stuff, and had a sense that there was a God. And then I went to a scout camp when I was, 12, 13, 14, and 15, and it took me a few years. And towards the end of those 4 years of going each year, I heard a Bible talk, and I know lots of you heard me say this before. And the man at the front said, he just explained really clearly from the Bible the kind of God that we have, a great God who holds us in his hand and has made the world and made us for his purposes. Not just made us kind of, you know, off you go, but made us for himself and cares for us and has like stuff for us to do. And the dairy farmer said that all of us turn away from God. All of us just go off on our own way. And I knew in that moment that I knew the meaning of sin. And I'm a pretty nice, kind of boring, nice kid, you know, at that stage. And I knew that I hadn't done much stuff that was very kind of naughty or wrong. I was a goody two-shoes kind of boy. But I knew that I was full of sin. Because if God is like that, then I haven't lived right. If he has made me for his own purposes, then I know that I've just maybe lived a nice, boring life, but not facing him, not directed towards him. And I just felt in that moment during the talk, I thought, whoa, that's huge. I'm stuffed. I really felt quite stuffed. But I thought that it was fair. And I thought it was just. And I thought, well, that's the end of the talk. That's fair enough. And the reason I felt like it's fair enough because of the kind of God that we have, a God who holds you in his hand in all your ways. Now, yes, that's all I'm going to say. That's the God we have, and that's the God you must not, and your friends must not set themselves up against, because he will bring you low. All all right, now Daniel is going to not just give the context of the inscription, but he's going to talk about the inscription. Verse 25, this is the inscription that was written. Mene, mene, tekel, parson. Must have been so strange to, I mean, I guess the king could actually already read it, you know, because it was in Aramaic on the wall. But it made no sense, right? Remember, dollar, dollar, kilogram, division sign. And verse 26, this is what we need, this is what the king wants. Verse 26, here is what the words mean. And this is true for you and your friends and being a blessing to them. They might know what scripture says. They might know about how Jesus died on the cross. But to them, it might just be like a dollar sign. It's a thing that I know about from culture or from, you know, someone told me when I was little. But they don't know what it means. And our place is to speak spiritual realities because we have the Spirit of God who's revealed it and made it clear and alive for us. And we speak the meaning of it. So verse 26, mene, says Daniel. And there's some really great stuff that I'm not going to try and explain because I only did 1 year of Hebrew. It seems like in Aramaic and Hebrew, you have just the consonants, 1, 2, 3 in most words. But then you have the vowels, which are like dots in different places near the consonants. And it seems like, from what I saw this week, that he puts the vowels in and that gives quite a fair bit of meaning. Anyway, a bit of context for you guys to look up if you want to. Okay, here is what the words mean, he says, verse 26. Mene, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel. You've been weighed, you know, like kilogram kind of idea. You've been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Peres, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. It's still quite short, but it's much more, it has a lot more meaning now than just those words. It's like he kind of, I was reading, it's like he turns nouns into verbs using the vowels. Okay, and so what he says is your days are numbered, you've been weighed and found wanting, and your kingdom is divided, and it's going to be handed over and given to the Medes. It's a message of judgment. It's a message of judgment. And the story in Belshazzar come now to their grisly end. Daniel chapter 5, verse 29. Then at Belshazzar's command, Daniel was clothed in purple, a gold chain was placed around his neck, and he was proclaimed the third highest ruler. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain. Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62. It's a horror story. It's terrible. He's killed that night. And there's some really interesting stuff you can go and read about the history of these kingdoms that they do. So non-biblical, non-Christian writers say the night that Babylon was besieged by Darius the Mede, because we know about him from other historical sources, there seemed to have been this great feast that was going on because they knew that the enemy forces were coming. Anyway, and it happens, and he dies that very night. And as I said, I want to just right now gather up those 3 points and make sure that you take them and reorient them and just let it line up so you know where you are. I wonder what surface washing around you. I wonder just where things are up to this week. But let God reorient you with these 3 things that you, if you're a Christian person, have been placed amongst your friends and your neighbors. And I look around and I feel excited because I know how some of you are connected with your neighbors and with your workplaces. God's got a place for you and a role for you to play. I want you to take that seriously. God wants you to take that seriously. Secondly, I want you to see who this God is. He is the God who holds your life in his hands and all your ways and your friends. That's the God we proclaim. That's the one we're talking about. Not just the God who's kind of set things up and just doing what, but he's got a plan and a purpose for us. He loves you. And I haven't given you the third one. Here's the third one. I've been through this story. This God speaks. This is the third pole to line up with. This God speaks. And particularly, he speaks to non-Christian people. Daniel wasn't in the room, and God started to speak with a hand on the wall, didn't he? And I just wonder, and I want to lift your eyes like my eyes have been lifted by this story this week. I wonder how God might be speaking to some of my friends, and I don't even know about it yet, but he's raised an arm, and they're sitting there thinking, who could I ask? But God has already probably started working. I'm sure he started working in our friends' lives, because he is the God who speaks. And this is what I want to say as I draw things to a close. that night, he said terrible things to Belshazzar. Just things, because of how much Belshazzar had set himself up. But he spoke with a hand and said terrifying things. But he's spoken more than just there to Belshazzar. He's spoken not just with a hand, but John chapter 1 says, the word, the center of the universe, has become flesh and made his dwelling among us. Not just as a hand writing on the wall, but the Lord Jesus has come as a whole body in human person to speak and to be God to us. God has spoken in Jesus. And he says some terrifying things, he really does. But he also says so many beautiful things that are for our friends. And I want to take you to John chapter 8 and just notice some of the beautiful and similar things going on here. In John chapter 8, it says, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, which really interestingly, the law of Moses was said to be written by the finger of God on stone tablets. Do you remember that in Exodus? And then in Deuteronomy, a second set, written with the finger of God, it says. Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, it commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap, it says, in order to have a basis for accusing them. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? No one, sir, she said. Then neither do I condemn you, Jesus declared. Now go and leave your life of sin. God has spoken not only in strange, weird ways in the past, handwriting the law. He's spoken in the person of Jesus right there to welcome people. He says to a woman who would have been killed by that point, I don't condemn you. Now, he's got a place for her to go because she belongs to God. And so he says, leave your life of sin. I've got other stuff for you. But he doesn't condemn her. I'm not going to condemn you. And this is the truth that we had. You know, the night that I became a Christian, I felt it was completely just that I be condemned. I thought, if he holds me in his hand like that, I am not the kind of person that lives for him. I just go about life without him. And I thought the talk was over, but gloriously it wasn't. He went on, he said, and this God loves you even in your sin and welcomes you in without condemnation because he's laid that condemnation on Jesus instead of you. And so if you want life with him, if you hear the message that he holds in your hand, you want life with him, you come to him, you ask for forgiveness. So I did, I became a Christian that night. We have good news for our friends. We have deep spiritual truth to share with our friends. And it's beautiful. That this God that we've set ourselves up against, who holds us in his hands, has come close in Jesus. And at the cross, his hands were pierced for you. Nailed to the cross because he loves you that much. This is the God that we have. Holds us in his hands pierced for us, and makes clear spiritual reality for you. Three things to take tonight. We've got a job as a Christian person to be ready to be called upon, to be known to be called upon. Two, what kind of a God is this? It's the God who holds you in his hand in all your ways. And thirdly, this is a God who speaks. And so hope and pray and look for your friends to hear from the God who speaks. Because he might be speaking apart from them. They're the things that I want you to take away from this. And let them line up and just, all right, where you are, that's right. That's the kind of God I have. And that's the kind of role I have. And this is the kind of stuff he does. He speaks. I'm going to look for that. Let that orient you tonight. Let me leave to pray.